Hey there, amazing audience who have joined the Revolving Time today. Subscribe now and let's uncover the hidden secrets and truths together. Today, we're diving into a topic that's tough, but one that each and every one of us might encounter on our journey, dealing with deceit and betrayal. Well, my friends, today's story is published by Colin Theddock. My suspicion was right and got proof that wife is cheating on me, so I'm doing it with her and her boyfriend. Well, let the story begin and I hope you enjoy it. My mate John, his father-in-law had sadly just died, and so his brother-in-law had stayed with John and his wife for a few days for the funeral and such. It was shortly after he returned to his diocese that he was arrested. Once John found out why he was arrested, he panicked and phoned me. "Greg, mate, July's brother is getting done for ducking Sihuar boys," he complained. I thought it was part of his job. I joked, "That may be, but the perverted bast has been using my computer, who knows what's on it. So why did you call me?" "Well, I know duck all about computers, but I know enough that it needs wiping and I have lots of SHT I don't want to lose, and you know a lot more about that SHT and you have the same machine. Can you sort it out for me? It'll take me hours and hours, maybe even days," I complained. "Please, mate, I will pay you. If I take it to the filth, they will confiscate it." So an hour later, I am wiring his hard drive unit into my monitor and keyboard. The first thing I did was install a scrubber program and wiped his browser history with it so I wouldn't find out any of his guilty secrets. I know I wouldn't want anyone checking mine. Then I spent a couple of hours saving some of his work to a plug-in hard drive after examining each file for hidden files that shouldn't be there. He phoned me the next day and asked if I had finished it yet. "Duck off," I said, "it would take a while. I'll let you know when I'm done." "Not only joking, mate. I just wanted you to know there is a secret keylogger on it. I put it on when the kids lived at home. It might help you find SHT, cut down how much work you have to do." "Good thinking," I replied. "Update." He told me how to make it visible and after dinner I checked it. His was a similar system to mine, and as it was fitted where my system should be, I guess Jane hadn't noticed any difference other than the wallpaper. I found she had logged into a CDmail account I didn't know she had. Everything I needed was right there in the keylogger. Call it curiosity or being just plain nosy, I logged into it. That was when my world ended. "Baby, I can't wait until you are back in England. I read I have booked tattoos and wed off work so we can have both days together. I am on the 2 to 10 shift and will tell Dan I will shop after work. That should give us till well after 11 to make whoopee." It was dated today, so it was probably in 3 weeks' time. She did 3 alternating shifts, days, nights, and lates. Today was Wednesday. It seems my wife has been playing with me. A one-sided game, and it was a game I had lost. Now it was time for me to play with her and her partner. I would use the same rules. She would not know, neither would he. I knew who he was, but I must admit I thought I had seen the last of him years ago. He had moved from America with his family years ago when I was in my last year at school. We had met at a disco. I say met, we had an argument. I was with a girl called Diane and he had started to chat her up whilst I was getting us a drink. When I got back with the drinks, I could see I had already lost in the game of love. "Hi, I'm Chuck. I'm from the US of A," he announced in that overconfident drawl they speak, as if he expected me to be impressed. "Chuck," I said. "Chuck, Chuck, Chuck. Here, Chuck, Chuck, Chucky," sounding like I was calling chickens like my granddad did when he fed them. "I mean, how do you turn Charles into Chuck? That still confuses me. Why are you saying that?" he drawled. "Well, over here in the civilized world, the word Chuck means to throw, or it can be said Chuck, which is a pet name for chickens. So are you a throwaway or a chicken?" Well, that was when he pushed me, or tried to. I blocked his wild swing and gave him the proverbial Glasgow kiss, a headbutt in more universal terms, and he dropped like a stone. Well, that was it. Diane officially chucked me, and I got chucked out of the dance and went home early, sans girlfriend. Diane only stayed with Chucky Boy for a few weeks before she got replaced. He went through a few women at regular intervals. His last one lasted 6 months, or so I thought. He moved with his family back to the States, and a few months later I was going with his most recent ex, you guessed it, Janie. I scrolled through the emails, all thought of dealing with John's computer gone from my mind. His punctuation was still abysmal, no capital letters, the occasional full stop. I was still reading them when she got home. I shut down the computer wondering what to do. Suddenly an idea jumped into my head. I moved to another chair. When she came in, I didn't speak, didn't welcome her home with a drink and a kiss as I normally do. "Something wrong, darling?" she asked. It took a few seconds before I answered. "Should there be?" "No, darling. I haven't done anything wrong, have I?" "Don't know, have you?" "Don't think so, but you seem to be off. It's just that today at work, Bert mentioned that D-head yank, and it's brought back bad memories." I lied. "Bad memories, but as far as I am concerned, good news and funny too." "D-head, I don't know who you mean." "Yeah, you do, Charles Weinstein III, or Chucky as most called him. You went with him for a while, didn't you? Her face flushed and she gave a furtive glance at the computer. Yes, but nothing serious. I was mostly just keeping him company while he was preparing to go back home. What did Bert say about him anyway? I ignored her question and asked. You ever hear anything from him after he ducked off back over there? No, no, nothing. You okay, Jane? Are you hot? No, I'm fine. Why? You look hot. I bet you say that to all the girls. I did not reply or smile at her joke. He's got AIDS apparently. Well, HIV. What? Who? You asked what Bert said. Apparently Chucky has spent some time in Africa and has been getting a lot of black. As I spoke, her color changed from red to white faster than a traffic light. But he wasn't gay. Oh, you know, that just means he was hiding it. You know, Alabama isn't exactly gay friendly. We had a fight because he made a pass at me. I thought that was over Diane. No, it was because he wanted to bet me he could give a better job than her. I don't be. She caught herself. She was about to say she didn't believe me. I'm really sure she was. She then asked, how does Bert know this? He has a cousin that's gay and HIV positive. I smiled at the discomfort in her face. I think I'll turn in. I haven't the luxury of laying in bed half the day. I announced. Oh yeah, good night. She replied. For some reason, I got the idea she was a little bit preoccupied. Update 1. I slept surprisingly well. The joy of what I had just done almost made up for the betrayal and now inevitable divorce. I awoke before the alarm, a good half hour early. I got up and headed downstairs, turning on John's PC before I made my morning coffee. The keylogger told me that she had logged into her CDmail account and sent an email. You ducking SHT. How are you going to do that to me? Did you have it the last time we were together, you bast? Don't ever contact me ever again, just ducking, hurry up and die, you bast, and then rotten HLL. And his reply. What do you mean, Janie Jane? Her reply back. Duck off, you AIDS-ridden bast. His reply. Janie love, are you saying you think I have AIDS or are you on about something else? And again hers. I know all about. The man you have been arranging it with is a cousin of a bloke that Greg works with. His reply. Greg must know something, lover. It's not true, really. Her. If he knew, he would have said something. And either way, I will not be meeting you ever again. I will get tested tomorrow. Him. It's not true, honest lover. Him. Janie, really Jane, I am not telling you a lie. I smiled, happy at the result but a little bit pissed off that he had sussed me. I then found she had been checking up how and where to get herself checked. I chuckled to myself. I cleared the history and shut it down. As I was up early, I had time for another coffee before I left for work. I got home and checked her CDmail again. No more from either. I set about doing the work on John's PC. By the time Jane was home, I had got about halfway through the work he wanted saving. As yet, I had found nothing. What you doing, darling? She asked. I looked at her. She still looked worried. Just some things for John. I replied. Oh, did Bert say any more about you, Charles? Oh, yes. Apparently some tramp he has been ducking when he's over here has found out about him and he is none too happy cause she's told him to duck off. I paused for dramatic effect, trying to look suddenly horrified. It's not you, is it? Do I need to get checked? I must admit I hoped she would deny it. I wanted to continue the wind-up. If she admitted it, we would start talking divorce, but before I did that, I wanted to deplete our bank accounts first. But she caught me by surprise. She fainted. I thought to myself, duck her, and left her lying on the floor. When she hadn't moved after 5 minutes, I called for an ambulance. They arrived just as she was coming round. They took her away to get checked out. I told the ambulance men that I would follow. Once they had gone, I logged in again to her account. I looked back again through the mails and noted that he came over about every 2 months. The last time was about 6 weeks ago, so even if she got a negative test, she still couldn't be sure. She would have probably had a quick urine test today if she had gone for a test, which I assume as expected was negative, but she would also have had blood taken, which apparently will take 2 weeks. Oh dear, the suspense, when will it end? Another thought entered my head at that point. Her CD address was sick. I opened a new one. I sent the new address to him, telling him I thought he was right and that Greg was suspicious. I then deleted it from the sent items. Now I should get mails from both, and any they received should be from me. I cleared the history and got ready to drive to the hospital. When I got there, she had been admitted for observation and was laying on a bed in a hallway, waiting to be taken to a ward. She didn't speak to me. She just lay there staring at the ceiling. It worked well enough for me. I hung around for half an hour and headed home. I went to bed and slept the sleep of the righteous. In the morning, I checked all 3 accounts he had answered to the new account. Janie love, see you soon. I am clean honest. I didn't reply. After all, she is in hospital. When I got home from work Friday night, she was home. Hello, I said as I walked into the lounge. What's for tea? You could ask why I fainted. Yes, I could. But do I want to? By the way, my test was negative. How about yours? I haven't had a test. I don't need one. Bert was on the phone to his cousin today at lunch. Apparently Chucky is not a happy chappy because his tramp wouldn't reply to his emails last night. You know, while you were in hospital unable to get to a computer. I looked at her for her reaction. That was weird. She looked both red and white at the same time. I think she nearly passed out again. When I was able to check the mails again, he was asking why she hadn't replied. He had mailed both accounts of hers. I deleted the one on her account and replied to him from my account. I told him I had been doing some deep thinking about what she wanted and wanted him to give her a few days and please stop using the other account. He replied almost immediately, "Perhaps the best is in love. I was once, but I now think it's overrated. It can only lead to pain." Him to her from me. Okay, if that's the way you feel, then duck. You put up with your low-class husband and you're ducking low-class life. I can get any whore to dot and no doubt do a better job. I think that is the correct vernacular. Hopefully it will be good enough for her to read through her tears. Update 2. I walked down the pub in the afternoon on Saturday and watched the Six Nations and sank a couple of beers. England won their match, so a couple of beers became a few. Yes, I think the gods were smiling on me today. By the time I got home, Jane was in bed. I decided I was too drunk to do anything on the computer, so I turned the telly on and got myself a bottle of beer. I fell asleep watching some film. I woke up about 5 with a dry tongue and a need to pee. I sorted the tongue out first and necked an almost full carton of orange juice. The noise I made while having a pee must have awoken her. She joined me as I was making coffee. "Where were you last night?" she spat. "Down the pub," I replied pleasantly. "I thought you would want to talk about this stupid idea you have got into your head," she said angrily. "It seems we have both been disappointed then," I replied, trying to sound nice, unable to keep a hint of sarcasm from my voice. "What have you got to be disappointed about?" she screamed. "A couple of things, you know, like being fairly sure I would not catch AIDS, and having a faithful wife." "You are talking out of your ass. I have not been ducking Chuck," she screamed again. "And I have not got ducking AIDS. So it's just a coincidence then. It's some other poor bass that I work with that has an AIDS-ridden tramp in his bed," I said, still unable to keep the sarcasm out of my voice. "Poor bast, he has my sympathy. After all, not only is his missus a scrubber, but he's lumbered with her now. He can't exactly go out and get a new bird. I mean, who goes around spreading a disease like that around? I supposed you would have to be a sick. I mean to do that to someone and not tell them or at least say sorry. The BTCH deserves it though, going round spreading for someone with or without a rubber. No, it's the poor bast she's married to that gets my sympathy." I had heard a commotion behind me. When I turned, she was on the floor passed out. Must have been something I said. I shrugged and finished my coffee first before calling the ambulance again. They came and took her away again. Once they had gone, I checked the mails again. Chucky had been good and not hassled her. She, however, had not been pleased when she had read her mail. No wonder she had been crying. But she had not sent it. It was in the drafts folder. From her to him. "You really are one sick piece of SHT. Greg calls you Chucky. When you come here, you will pay for what you have done to me. When I have got through with you, you will never be able to do that to anyone else. No love, Janie, no." I grinned. Seems like things may be better than I thought. Time to stir the pot, I think. I typed one from her to him. "Chucky babe, I think you might be right. I think he has made up the AIDS story to scare me to try and teach me a lesson. But because he has not directly accused me, I think he is more worried about losing me than stopping me have fun with you. Let's face it, he worships me and couldn't live without me. I will meet you as we arranged. See you soon. Can't wait. Jay." I grinned as I pressed send, then set about writing one from him to her. "Janie, I was pissed when I sent you that last mail. I am really sorry, I didn't mean any of it. None of it is true. Can we still meet up if only to talk? I really do care about you. Chuck." I went out and bought myself a new laptop and called in at a couple of estate agents looking for possible flats. Then I went to see the BTCH. She was in a ward when I found her. I looked down at her in her bed and putting on my best game face, I said, "You're right, babe. I have been unfair, jumping to conclusions like that. It's just that I love you so much, and the thought of you being with anyone else, especially him. Well, it got to me. I couldn't bear losing you, and if he had given you that disease, I don't know what I would do." I had reached down and taken her hand in mine as I spoke. I just hoped I had not laid it on too thick. "Do you really believe me, darling?" she said softly. "Yes, love. Of course I do." I lied. Update 3. They kept her in hospital for a couple of days, doing numerous tests. They found nothing wrong as far as they could tell. I got a call while I was at work to fetch her. I had told my boss that she was ill, and I might need a few days off to look after her. So after telling him I had to go, I left and went and picked her up. I was given a long list of things she wasn't to do, which could be summarized by two sentences: don't let her overexert herself, and don't let her get stressed. I took her home and made her feel loved, waited on her hand and foot. I played the ever-loving and attentive husband, very difficult at first, but I soon learned. The emails from Jane to the him went back and forth. It seems they were patching things up to an extent. With my help, later in the week I was sometimes just copying text and transferring it to the correct addresses. To be honest, it became a bit of a chore. The fun had pretty much gone out of it. Since my discovery, I had been taking the random amounts of cash out of our joint accounts, and everything I bought, I paid for on the debit card. Now, while she was basically under house arrest for a few days, I took the cash maximum out, using her card, £500 a day. I used her card at the cash machines and mine whenever I bought something with a card. I viewed a couple of flats as well on my outings. Come the day of reckoning, there would be little in it. By the next Sunday, she was encouraging me to return to work, insisting she would be all right and promising me she would not do too much. I told her it was already booked off and it would be too much hassle to reverse it. Plus, she was signed off sick so could not return to work until she was fit for work. I suggested we went away somewhere for a week. After all, I was taking my holiday. I may as well have one. Shame I had to drag her along as well. We had a week in Brighton to enjoy long walks on the beach, or gravel as it's called in the rest of the country. Somehow we managed to leave her purse at home, so she had no bank card. By the time we got home the following Saturday, our bank had less than 1,000 in it and she had no idea. I eventually found her purse. It had slipped down the arm of a chair. It took me hours to find it. I am sure that was one of the first places I looked. Guess what? Her card was missing from it. We reported it stolen. I smiled. If she were lucky, the new one would arrive Tuesday. As the great Hannibal Smith says, I love it when a plan comes together. We had notified the BTCH had gone away for a week. Once we had reported her card stolen, I popped out, and to get her some money in reality, I drove to the local McDonald's and used their Wi-Fi. On my nice, new 2-week-old laptop, I passed on some slightly adjusted mails before returning home. I gave her £30 and she complained it wasn't enough. I insisted she had no need for any. All she was supposed to do was stay at home and get better. It took a while, but she relented. I went back to work the next day. For lunch, I hit McDonald's again and used the Wi-Fi. From him to her. Lover, will get to the new inn around 2 a.m. I am looking forward to talking with you. I hope we can put this silly misunderstanding behind us. I am in room 212. Chucky. I passed that on. Then from her to him. I will be there around 3. Remember, we are just meeting to talk. No X's, it keeps getting better. But I thought I could improve on it. I sent a slightly different one to him from her. I can't wait, lover. I want you to rip my clothes off as soon as you see me. J. Final update. When I got home that night, she had actually cooked dinner and she welcomed me with a kiss and a beer. Perhaps she had gotten her results through. She was being really nice. I got the impression she was going to instigate love, which intrigued me. I had expected none tonight. Perhaps she really was only going to talk with him. After dinner, I continued the work for John. By 9 o'clock, I had copied and investigated everything he wanted to keep. I checked the mails. Neither had mailed the other. I then set the scrubber program running to wipe everything off it. Once that was done, I formatted the disk a few times and left it running to reload Windows. Then I went to bed. I soon discovered my earlier suspicions were correct and I got royally ducked. I had originally thought about waiting at the new inn and confronting them just after she arrived, but because of the spanner I had thrown into the works, I had decided to leave it till after work. I went to work as normal. I set the scrubber program running on my laptop to clean all but the operating system. At 5 o'clock I left my office and drove to the new inn. The car park had several police vehicles in it. I chose discretion as the better part of valor and drove on by. I headed home. I reloaded John's data all back on his system, and once I had done that, I called him to come and get it. Einstein reckons nothing travels faster than the speed of light. I may not be as clever as him, but I know he is wrong. There is one thing that travels faster. Boomer. I hadn't even got to tell him his PC was ready to collect before I was told the police were at the new inn. Apparently, according to the rumor mill, a jealous husband had finished his wife's lover. Oh, I thought, so I wasn't the only dumb bast. I set about plugging my PC back in. John came and fetched his. He had no more gossip to tell me. I had a visitor an hour or so later, a policeman. He wanted to come in so he and some other officers could search my house. I demanded to know why, and he refused to enlighten me. I thought about being belligerent, but I had nothing to hide, so I relented and let them in. A detective and a couple more uniforms turned up 10 minutes later. I was pleased I had already agreed to the search when the detective handed me a warrant. What are you looking for and why? I asked. Evidence to see whether the attempted murder by your wife has committed was preplanned. Pardon? I asked, genuinely shocked. What do you mean murder? It seems your wife met with a man today and finished him. I did my best not to laugh as I said. I hope he lives. I meant it too. I wanted him to know and remember who he played with. Again, I say as the great Hannibal Smith often said, I love it when a plan comes together. But he never had one work this well. As always, thanks for watching. Remember, Revolving Time exists because of your support. So take care of yourself and see you soon with another story.